you have some water to clean it, so let's move this out of the way. Happy Sunday to you. How you doing?
How about those Astros?
Yeah. No one expected them to be there.
Got to.
They are kind of like a Cinderella story.
That's right.
And this is their first time ever in the World Series, right. Isn't it? Mm. How's it make you feel, man?
Look, I come from D.C. back in the day when the Redskins were the real Redskins. 83, 84, 87, 92. And we're, you know, now it's just it's a hot mess there. You know?
We don't mind the hot mess.
I still stick with them. I stick with the Bullets, who are now the Wizards. When I was growing up, there weren't the Nationals.
I know, it's awful. It's awful.
Can you just hear me?
Can you guys hear me? No, we had easy lights. For people recording and stuff, too, because there are plenty of the boat. But.
What's up, dude? So I'm happy for D.C. D.C.'s a good town. I'll be pulling for them, but the Astros are there. And that's as good as a baseball game can get, you know, how it was last night.
Well, see, I love it. You're a true baseball fan because you show a true appreciation. It doesn't matter what the team is when you see some good playing. It's
good ball is good ball, yeah.
Yeah. What did you think about, L2, they just hit it out of the park.
Yeah, so
we thought it was safe.
I hit the Yankees. You gotta hit the Yankees.
I'm not saying he said that. I got too many friends who are gonna hurt me if I said that. Alright. Yeah, you gotta be true. Be true. Okay, no problem. You can do whatever you want. This is your panel. Even though I'm gonna, point some things out here. But first and foremost, thanks again for being here. We really appreciate it. Have you had a good time in H-Town?
Yeah, I love Houston.
Can we hear you? Can you hear him?
Can you hear me?
No.
Can you hear me?
What? Talk again.
Microphone check.
Did you turn? Hold on. We got so excited. I hope you didn't turn it off by accident. Okay, we're going to need another microphone. Come on up. In the meantime, I'll go like this. Back up.
All right.
Okay, so what have you been doing in H-Town?
Oh, well, I mean, really just being here, meeting great people. You know, that's been most of what I'm doing. But I'm driving to Shreveport today. Shreveport, huh? All right, girl. Yeah, I love Shreveport. Shreveport's my heart. I've been going to Shreveport on and off for the last 7 years.
What's up, dude?
He's got his own mic.
Thank you very much.
You know, batteries.
Hello?
Yeah, there we go. Heading to Shreveport.
Yeah, so yeah, I'm heading to Shreveport today. We've been working on a project. True story about something that happened down there. So it'd be good to see all my people in Shreveport.
That's cool.
Yeah.
And can you give us a hint on it so we can support it?
It's coming. You'll see. Yeah, it's coming.
All right.
It's called the Bottoms. Yeah, you'll like it.
Just let us know so we can throw the support out there.
Rock and roll.
I'll give it to you.
Thank you.
All right. So you play some iconic roles, and we know that. I mean, one thing, though, that sticks in my mind when I look at you, I still see you on the phone. I do. I'm sorry. Just a little bit. I love that museum, Smithsonian. I love that.
All right.
I remember that. I mean, did you have fun on that?
Yeah. Look, I feel so blessed to do what I do. I did not come from a place where many people do this, and I'm enormously grateful. I got into a lot of trouble when I was a kid, and I didn't have sort of the most direct road or the clearest road, and this thing kind of, man, I hate that echo. I feel like that's scary as heck.
It's all good. But, it doesn't bother you.
I always have a good time. I'm enormously grateful that I get to do this. You know, when I was a kid, I remember being in the doctor's office and there was a book about Babe Ruth, and he was it was a little cartoon book, and he would lean up against the wall of a stadium, and he'd be like all fat and stuff, and popping hot dogs into his mouth. And this little kid said, "Hey, Babe, how you doing, man?" He's like, "I get paid to play baseball and eat hot dogs. What could be better?" And I kind of feel like that somehow. I work really hard. I take it enormously seriously. But I'm grateful for just that I get to do this. You know, very grateful every day.
You get paid to play.
Yeah, and
in your own way, in different characters.
Yeah. And I care enormously about the people that care about these parts. I mean, I think with from everything from Shane to Frank Castle, these characters belong. Hearts and the minds of the comic book fans that have loved these characters and sort of created these characters in their own imagination. my job to fully respect that, to fully respect all the members of law enforcement and military that these characters have meant so much to, and study the hell out of it, train the hell out of it, and then to put my own spin on it. And that's something I'm just, it's a responsibility that I take enormously seriously, but I never forget just how lucky I am to be doing it.
Thanks for sharing that.
Oh, rock and roll, yeah, sure.
So how did you end up getting the part of Shane in the first place?
Shane?
Yeah.
Audition. Everybody, you know, I read that script, and it was, Frank Darabont, he had done Shawshank Redemption. I read that script, and it was the best script I'd ever read, best pilot script I ever read. And I had auditioned for a part on, I believe, NCIS LA, and I had gotten it, and I was going to go do that show. I would still be doing that show, but I had read that script, and I said, I can't take this part until I at least audition for The Walking Dead. And everybody thought I was out of my damn mind, but I was like, I just gotta try. And I originally auditioned for Rick. Everybody auditioned for Rick first, and then they brought us all back. They had about 10 folks that they were real interested in. And normally these auditions are the most artificial, worst-ass things you ever seen. Like, you go into a room with a bunch of people in suits, and you do the scene in front of them, and they're all awkward and don't know what they're looking at, and they're thinking about numbers and all this bullshit. And it's a real kind of artificial kind of situation. But Frank Darabont did something very different. For the audition for Walking Dead, he had all the people that he was interested in, all the Ricks and Shanes, and he brought them all into a soundstage. And there's, I don't know if y'all remember season one of The Walking Dead, but there was a first time you meet Shane. It's like Rick and Shane in that car, and Shane's talking to him about turning to how women always leave the damn lights on. And, you know, it's a real beautiful scene about these, two best friends who are really sitting there, and he's asking his best friend for kind of help with his wife. Little does he know he's going to be sleeping with his wife a little bit late. You know, it's like she goes from, like, super freaking south, you know, real quick. But, like, it's this kind of beautiful scene. And so the way that the audition for that went is they had a sound stage, they had a real police car, they rigged it for sound and lights, just like you were on set. And they had all the 10 people that were auditioning against each other. Frank said, you guys are all going to spend the day together. And, you know, normally you just walk in, walk out, you give each other kind of shitty, icy stares on the way out, you know, that's my part. But we were going to spend the day, and everybody got to read with each other. And it was a real testament to that. Frank wanted the best work possible on that show. Get all the ego bullshit out of the way. He wanted it to be great. We all ate lunch together, you know, and it was funny. Like, by the end of the day, a lot of the actors were kind of coming undone. They were like, all right, well, you read your Rick with that Shane. Who's better? Was I better? Was he? You know, and I remember praying the night before I went in. I just said, I just want to be me tomorrow. Just don't let the situation get the better of you. Because I wanted it real bad. And I said, just be graceful and gracious to everybody. And it was really a beautiful process. And that's a long-ass answer to a short-ass question.
But it was perfect.
So they ended up casting Shane. They cast me as Shane. That's really the part that I wanted. And then they couldn't find a Rick. But then we kept bringing Ricks in. And instead of a they couldn't afford the soundstage anymore, so we would shoot at Frank's garage in his car. And one of my old pit bulls would be in the back. And when Andy Lincoln came in, we knew immediately this was the guy. The only problem was my dog was snoring through his audition. He was like in the back of the car. We were doing the scene, and what is that freaking noise? And like, we just put his ass to sleep. We bored the shit out of him. And so yeah, it was pretty pretty crazy.
Well, it's better to be sleeping than barking or not.
Rock and roll, I hear you. And as soon as Andy came, it was like, yeah, that's the guy. That makes total sense.
That's cool. Well, I talked to Pollyanna Cooper yesterday about just being on that set. And you guys basically did a scene with finished an entire episode so quickly, all of the time, because it's like you're just punching them out within like 8 days doing an entire episode, or maybe even shorter than that. What was that kind of experience being on that set?
Walking Dead. I mean, like, Walking Dead for me is probably real different than the folks that are on it now. You know, when we did Walking Dead, you know, there were no trailers, there was no craft service, there was no, you know, we would just hike out into the woods. It was very humble. Nobody thought the show was going to be what the show was. We got picked up for 6 episodes. That is not like a big vote of confidence, you know. It was like a zombie show, but that thing sucks. Like, that's gonna really suck, you know. So, and at that point, AMC was the network of like Mad Men and Breaking Bad, and they didn't want anybody messing with their prestige television, and we were kind of, I think at first sort of treated like, you know, the wart on their ass, you know what I mean? Excuse my language, but you know what I mean? I apologize, but it's Texas, y'all, you know what I mean? So she's like, I'm taking my baby out of here. I figured, I didn't see any other kids. I usually hate cursing for a kid, but I figured she's too young to know anyway, right? I'll stop, I'll try to hold it together. I have kids too, and I really don't like when people curse in front of kids, man. But my wife says I gotta be better about that. No, but look, I wouldn't have it any other way. You know, it was, you know, when you think about it, a zombie show, you put seven people out there in the woods and you say, there's zombies out there. If one person isn't going absolutely as hard as they can, if you got seven people that are absolutely playing it real 100% of the time, that there's zombies everywhere, but then one person is sitting there kind of worried about their makeup, or worried about how they look, or about vanity or some other bullshit, you ruin it for everybody. And everybody who was so committed to that show, the people who were there in the beginning of that show, they're ready to throw down whatever it took for that show. We'd be in those woods all day long. You might get bit by a snake, get bit by a spider, you just be there, and you go 100% all the time. And we all fed off each other that way. And look, those folks are still some of my best friends in the world, you know? And the bonds that were formed in the beginning of that show, a family was formed. I really loved how humble that show started. You know, we were all in it together. We didn't know it would be successful. We didn't even think about it. We believe in the script, we believe in each other, and we believe in this world. And you know, that's really what the show's about. It's about when you strip off the veneer of all the comfort and all the shit that makes us forget about how lucky we are to be here, and you gotta depend on each other to survive. That group really, really took to that with everything they had. And, I love my time on The Walking Dead. I loved being there when I was, and I loved getting out of there when I did.
Yeah,
you know?
That's called blood, sweat, and tears.
Yeah.
That's nice.
Yeah.
All right, it's time to talk about
the
show.
Okay. Oh, but that's me on the mic. So have y'all not been hearing me?
Yeah.
You okay? Because I hear myself. Okay.
Okay. How did you get that role? Did somebody call you? Did you? I mean, I know you auditioned for it, but
for Punisher?
Yeah, Punisher. How'd that go?
You know, they called and said that they were interested to come on to Daredevil to do Frank Castle. I wasn't really interested in doing any kind of superhero stuff. And I was really kind of at a place work-wise where I was doing exactly what I wanted to do. I was doing kind of like small, really cool roles in great movies, and then I kind of had my choice of a couple. I do a movie and I had my choice of a couple afterwards. That's kind of always what I wanted. And I didn't really have any desire to do anything differently. But when that came about, I hadn't seen Daredevil, but I watched it and I saw Charlie Cox's first monologue in the first episode of Daredevil. I said, "Damn, this dude is serious," and they're really letting him. They're sticking with him. It's a bold thing to let somebody have a 2-3 minute monologue in the beginning. He's basically like, "Y'all want to be bored? Y'all can leave. But we believe in this," and I really dug that. And then I saw what Vincent D'Onofrio was doing, and I saw how great that character was and how nasty they let him be, and I was like, shit, I want to mess around with these dudes. And then, the more I learned about Frank Castle, this is still to this day, the more I've learned about how much he means to people and what he means, and, being a husband and a father, and knowing really what it means to love others way more than I love myself and happily give my life for someone else, I really started to meditate on what it would be like to lose them and what that would mean. And, his superpower is the United States Marine Corps. And for me, that just did something to me that just scared the shit out of me. And I've always said that, like, with art, if something scares you, that's what you gotta run towards, The second you run to what's easy, you ain't gonna do nothing good. Like, you gotta run to what scares you. That role scared the heck out of me, so I was like, yeah, that's what I
do. Why did it scare you so much?
The level of darkness that he's got operated in, he's not looking to feel better. Frank's not looking to make everything okay. He's not looking to bring bad guys to justice. He lives in a world of darkness that there's no light at the end of the tunnel. And the only thing you can do to sort of squat. Sorry.
We don't want you to shut up.
All right.
And I mean, even though you say you're a better actor for us, you're an amazing actor.
I appreciate it.
Because of the role that you're playing. And also, I want to know, because you talked about being in this dark place, but you also gravitate a lot to a lot of people in the Marine Corps, because that is who your character was a part of. Do Marines come up to you? Do more military, current military? What do they say to you?
All kinds of things. I mean, and that's been the best part of not just playing Frank, but just my job, period. I've gotten to do, you know, I was in the Pacific. I got to do a movie called Fury. I got to do, you know, obviously Frank and a number of others. And I think, aside from just, you know, the folks that I meet, the people that have served, that have come up to me and talked to me about their own experiences, I have just like such admiration and respect and love for people who don't just talk the talk but walk the walk, and the armed services just, you know, like I think it's the best among us, and the folks that I've gotten to train with over the years, and not just train with weapons or protocol or how to handle yourself or carry yourself, but you know, mindset. Folks in the Special Forces community that have taken me in and opened up to me about their experiences, that's something I cherish, I treasure it. And they've become some of my best friends in the world, and I just feel like enormously grateful for that. And I think any time a vet opens up to you and talks to you about their experiences, it's just something you should consider yourself real blessed if you get that opportunity.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, so.
Speaking of which, do we have any current or active military in the audience right now? Can you stand up, please? Thank you for your service. We appreciate you being here today. While we do that, I'm asking another question, but I want people who want to ask him questions, can you start lining up at the two microphones? Because I know some people want to ask questions. There's one on your left and one on your right, so let's go ahead and line up real quick. What do you look forward to when you wake up in the morning?
Kissing my wife, hugging my kids. We got a crap load of animals right now, man. We got my wife.
I love animals.
My wife went and rescued these four damn kittens. I'm not a cat person. Oh, cats. She already rescued two, so we had two. And then, see, yeah, it's fucked up. I can tell you a story. I ain't gonna tell you, but like, no, I can't do that. No, because it'd be fucked up. But we got two cats, and then we got four kittens. And then we just rescued another pit bull. We got one. And then I got my pit bull Bam Bam. We lost two dogs this year, which was rough.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's part of the deal, but it's rough. But and then you know my kids got all these crazy ass animals, you know, like lizards and fucking little vermin and shit. You know, I hate animals, but like yes, we got a lot of animals, you know. And so like I love you know the dogs and I love the kids. You know, that's what I look forward to. Just you know. I'm on the road a lot, so my time at home that's my heaven, you know, and just being with my family, that's 100% what I look forward to.
Good for you.
Yeah, that's it.
Please
yeah.
Tell your wife thank
and
you.
A Kind Bar.
Yeah.
And a Kind Bar. Y'all eat Kind Bars. I'm addicted to these damn Kind Bars. That is what I look forward to also in the morning. Every morning, because I wake up before everybody. I get my coffee and a Kind Bar. Even when I go on the road, like this trip, I'm coming here, this Shreveport, I gotta go back, I take a Kind Bar for every day, and I never, it's like some people are like, I need a toothpaste, I need a toothbrush, I'm like that too, I brush my teeth real good, but like, the Kind Bars, that's like a non-negotiable, I need to have those things.
If you know the CEO for Kind Bars, contact them and let him do ads for Kind Bars, because he just did a great one.
I don't know, because I think there's something addictive about, like, I think they're pulling one over
really
on me, because I can't stop with it, you know what I mean? Anyway.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Your wife thank you for all the cats.
Okay, rock and roll.
All right, thank you.
Cats, like, I don't know about cats. What? It's like they go to the bathroom in the house, you know what I mean? They should be. They,
you go to the bathroom in the house?
Huh?
You go to the bathroom.
Even if it flushes, you know what I mean?
You
don't
like cleaning up after.
They're cute. Like, these little kids are cute as all. I'll show you some things. I mean, they're cute as all hell. I'll give it to you. And the dogs and them get along good. There's a lot of love, but I just, it's enough.
All right, let's get to some questions from our audience real quick. Let's start over here, ma'am. Go ahead. Get a little closer to the mic. I hope it's on. Can't hear you, Natalie. Well, I can, but I can't. Just talk loud. I'll hear you.
What has been your favorite memory on set, whether that was on The Walking Dead, The Punisher,
say Punisher, what else?
The
Night at the Museum. I was like, what was the other one? I was like, was I in that? Look, it's going to sound cheesy as all hell, but the best thing about it for me is the folks that I get to meet along the way, the cast, the crew, the people I get to work with. I've made some really, really good friends that I care about a lot. So just, being with everybody, I love the idea. I think there's something really American about it, something really that I dig about a group of people from all walks of life, all different kinds of beliefs, all different kinds of backgrounds, getting together to make something, like we make something every day. It's like we got a day, sometimes it's, 14 hours, sometimes it's 20 hours, but like we got this day, and we gotta make this, like we gotta make our day, and it takes a lot, you 200 people in that crew, lighting it and sound, and getting there, and the Teamsters that get us back and forth, and into the woods, and dealing with what's going on, and I just love being there with the group, getting it done, after I got killed off Walking Dead, they killed my ass off Walking Dead. They killed me twice. They were like, "You're definitely not coming back." They took my scripts. They were like, "You're done." And I had to drive. I was going to do a movie in Shreveport. I drove there and I came back to go pick some stuff up. And I was gonna come by set to see everybody, say goodbye. And I walked in and said it was like a 2 mile hike. I used to hike in every day. Everybody would take these little, cars, and I used to hike in. Me and Sarah Wayne Cowles were always hiking. We'd always go early and walk together. We walked in, and she said, "Come on to set. Everybody's waiting for you to see you." And I saw, the whole set. Everybody was up at Herschel's farm, and they're going to burn it down, and all this crazy stuff was going on. And I remember I couldn't walk up there because it was their thing now. And I just sat on this rock and just watched everybody, just the whole thing working, And I just, and I might have shed a couple tears, because I was going to miss them. But it was just I just appreciated it. I see these dudes who are playing zombies, going 100 miles an hour with all this shit on their face, shot tape, all this hell's breaking loose, and everyone's going forward, and there's, Scott Wilson, rest in peace, just acting his ass off, and I'm just like, man, how cool is this? And I didn't answer your question, I apologize for that. But the truth is, I don't have a favorite time. I really
All right, thank you, man. All right, over here.
Hi, John.
Sorry, this is dead battery.
All right, I'll be fine.
Okay, that's cool.
So, firstly, thank you so much for coming to Houston in the first place, because, you and Frank mean so much to me, and I love, both the character and you, so much, so it's, really amazing that you came here. And,
thank you, sweetheart. Thanks for having me.
So my question is, and since we don't discriminate here, if you could play any character in the DC universe, who would it be and why?
Shit, I don't know. Who would you want me to play?
Oh my god.
Right. See how I did that?
Yeah. I don't know. There's a lot. There's so many different types of characters in DC, so.
Yeah, I don't know. I really don't know. I really don't know. And I think a lot of it doesn't, people ask me all the time about how you pick stuff and what do you want to play. Again, I can just feel a cheesy-ass answer coming on, but I'm going to keep going. But I do believe in this. I think the best thing about what I do is it's tough. There's nobody who comes up here and does this for a living that didn't struggle for a long time and didn't have a lot of doors slammed in their face. And I had every kind of door you can imagine slammed in my face. I got a giant-ass nose, I got big old floppy ears. People are like, this is not going to work for you. And I remember going into auditions and casting directors never even looking up from their phone, and they wanted nothing to do with me. And that's hard, There's times where you go long periods of time, the phone doesn't ring, and I know what that's like. And it's a reality of this kind of work. But the cool thing is that great thing, that great job, that great love, that's out there. So I don't know what's out there, and that's part of the thing that I love about it. I don't know what the next great thing is, so I don't have my eyes on, I want to play the Hulk, or some shit like that. I just, if something comes to me and it's written well and it's with people I really want to roll with, I'm gonna roll. And if love you too, and I love Frank too. I really don't have any desire to move off of him.
Yeah.
Pam over here.
I'm Natalie.
What's up, Natalie? I met you yesterday, right? Yeah, right on. I mean, you know I can't talk about that.
She tried hard.
And like, by the way, honestly, y'all won't know before me. You know what I mean? They don't tell me shit. You know what I mean? Yeah. What'd you say? I thank you, sweetheart. I appreciate it. Look, you know, for me again, it's all about Frank. He needs to be portrayed in a very certain way, in my opinion. And again, he means so much to so many people in the comic book community, in the law enforcement community, in the military community. You don't just, in my opinion, you don't just do a Punisher. You don't just do a Frank Castle thing. You know, you got to do it. You got to do it right, and you got to respect, you know, what he stands for, what he's all about. And to me, that's what, if that works out, then I'll jump in with everything I have. And if not, I'm not done. You know, yeah. Rock and roll.
All right. Thank you for your question. All right, over here, please.
Frank Castle.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sheila.
Thank you. All right, good turn. I love the shirt.
Good morning.
Good
morning. So my question is, have you ever been hurt on set?
Oh, yeah. I mean, like, you know, we had a rule kind of on Punisher, you know. It's tough. I think the cool thing about, about those Marvel shows, those Netflix Marvel shows, is, you know, I think what sort of they're what made them stand apart a little bit is that we were trying to do movie level fights in a TV show, and so, you know, the brass tacks of that is that, like, you know, you're doing that, you know, you're trying to fit a movie level fight into the schedule of a TV show. So you know, in a movie you might have like 2 months to shoot an action scene. You rehearse it forever. We've got to rehearse it, learn it, shoot it, usually in an afternoon, you know, and it's much less time. So, you know, we just, kind of our saying on our show is, you do it real and you do it once. So it's like, if you're throwing someone through a wall, just throw them through the damn wall, do it hard, do it once. And like, honestly, I have deep, deep, deep respect for the stunt community. They're my brothers, they're the people I'm closest with on set. I think it's absolutely a crime that there's not an Academy Award for stunt performers. I think that the stunt community is, they're the ones that are really putting it on the line. The creativity that comes out of the stunt community is mind-boggling. And I think nowadays, it's one of the key reasons why people go and seek out entertainment, because of how good the stunts are, and there are people like actually doing that. And I train with those guys every day. I try to go in full out, and you know, it's kind of a mantra of a stunt guy, do it hard, do it once. You know, like, don't pull a punch, because then you're gonna have to do it 15 times. Just hit me and do it once. So we try to like kind of live by that. And so yeah, you know, I'm Punisher. I definitely got knocked unconscious a few times. I broke my hand, I tore some ligaments, dislocated my thumb. Yeah, there's a lot of injuries, you know, but all worth it. And you just keep it. That whole thing with, if you saw Punisher season 2, that whole thing with my broken hand, like my hand that got shot, that's because in that first bar fight, it was a 3-day fight, and on the first day I broke my hand, on the second day I tore a bunch of ligaments, and on the third day I dislocated, so they had to do an emergency surgery, so they wrote that thing in, because I had to go back to work the next day, so they just they wrapped up my hand, I kept shooting, and yeah, that's why that was in there. So you get hurt. Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, thank you.